diagnosis and staging of multiple myeloma. So in the diagnosis and staging, so the diagnosis of myeloma requires plasmacytosis. So in the diagnosis, it requires plasmacytosis greater than 10%. Marrow plasmacytosis, it is greater than 10%, and serum and or urine M component, and at least one of the myeloma defining events. Diagnosis of myeloma requires marrow plasmacytosis. Plasma cells should be greater than 10%, a serum and or urine M component, and myeloma defining event should be there. That is, some organ involvement should be there, along with plasma cells are increased. Along with that, their component, secreted component, is increased, and there should be some organ damage. Bone marrow plasma cells are CD138 positive. Bone marrow plasma cells are CD138 positive, and either monoclonal kappa or lambda light chain positive. Bone marrow plasma cells are CD138 positive. So plasma cells are CD138 positive, and either monoclonal kappa or lambda light chain positive. The most important differential diagnosis in patients with myeloma involves their separation from individuals with MGUS or smoldering multiple myeloma. So what is the most important differential diagnosis in patients with myeloma? So they have to be separated from individuals with MGUS or smoldering multiple myeloma. So MGUS, it is vastly more common than myeloma. MGUS is vastly more common than myeloma, occurring in 1% of the population aged greater than 50 years and in up to 10% of individuals aged greater than 75 years. So which is more common than myeloma? MGUS. So in patients aged greater than 50 years, it occurs in 1% of the population, and those aged greater than 75 years, it occurs in up to 10% of individuals. So the diagnostic criteria are described. Although 1% of patients per year with the MGUS go on to develop myeloma, all cases of myeloma are preceded by MGUS. 1% of the patients per year with MGUS to myeloma, only 1%, but all cases of patients whoever have developed myeloma, so they are preceded by this MGUS. Non-IgG subtype, abnormal kappa or lambda free light chain ratio, and serum M protein greater than 1.5 grams per deciliter are associated with higher incidence of progression of MGUS to myeloma. So what are the features which cause MGUS progression to myeloma? Non-IgG subtype, abnormal kappa or lambda free light chain ratio, and M protein greater than 1.5 gram per deciliter. So these are associated with higher incidence of progression of MGUS to myeloma. So absence of all the three features predicts a 5% chance of progression. So if all the three features are absent, it predicts only a 5% chance of progression, whereas higher risk MGUS with the presence of all three features, they predict a 60% chance of progression over 20 years. Whereas higher risk MGUS with presence of all three features, so this will predict a 60% chance of progression over 20 years. So what are the features responsible for higher risk of progression from so this is about MGUS progressing to multiple myeloma. So first of all, what is MGUS? MGUS means plasma cells, no? So they will be less than 10%. So because of this, what will happen? Monoclonal protein also will be less than 30 grams per liter, and their own, so plasma cells are less than 10%. Serum monoclonal protein, non IgM type, so this will be less than 3 grams per deciliter, and their absence of myeloma defining events or amyloidosis, so this that can be attributed to the plasma cell proliferative disorder. And the features responsible for higher risk of progression from smoldering multiple myeloma to multiple myeloma are bone marrow plasmacytosis greater than 10%, abnormal kappa or lambda free light chain ratio, and serum M protein greater than 3 grams per deciliter. So first of all, what is smoldering multiple myeloma? So this is also called as asymptomatic myeloma. Here what should be there is clonal bone marrow plasma cells, no? So here it will be 10 to 60%, but here monoclonal protein, it is greater than or equal to 3 gram per deciliter, and even urinary monoclonal protein, it is greater than or equal to 500 milligrams per 24 hours. But here, absence of myeloma defining events or amyloidosis, absence of myeloma defining events or amyloidosis. So what is symptomatic multiple myeloma? Symptomatic means clonal bone marrow plasma cells or biopsy proven bony or extramedullary plasma cytoma, and any one or more of the following myeloma defining events. So before going into this, we'll go back again. What are the features responsible for higher risk of progression of smoldering multiple myeloma to multiple myeloma? So bone marrow plasmacytosis greater than 10%, abnormal kappa lambda free light chain ratio, and serum M protein greater than 3 gram per deciliter. Here it is 1.5 gram per deciliter, here it is 3 gram per deciliter. And here also abnormal kappa or lambda free light chain ratio. So patients with only one of these three features, they have a 25% chance of progression to multiple myeloma in 5 years, whereas patients with high risk smoldering multiple myeloma, so with all the three features, they have a 76% chance of progression. So two important variants of myeloma are, so what are the two important variants of myeloma? So these are solitary bone plasma cytoma and solitary extramedullary plasma cytoma. So we have two important variants of myeloma. So these are solitary bone plasma cytoma and solitary extramedullary plasma cytoma. So these lesions, they are associated with a M component in less than 30% of the cases. Solitary bone and solitary extramedullary, here M component is less than 30% of the cases. They may affect the younger individuals, and both are associated LDH with median survival of greater than or equal to 10 years. So these lesions, M component in less than 30%, affecting younger individuals, and both are associated with LDH with median survival of greater than or equal to 10 years. So two important variants of myeloma are solitary bone plasmacytoma and solitary extramedullary plasmacytoma. So solitary bone plasmacytoma, so this is a single lytic bone lesion without any marrow plasmacytosis. What is a solitary bone plasmacytoma? It is a single lytic bone lesion without marrow plasmacytosis. Extramedullary plasmacytomas thus usually involve the submucosal lymphoid tissue of the, see here, solitary means single lytic bone lesion without any marrow plasmacytosis. Extramedullary plasmacytoma thus usually involve the submucosal lymphoid tissue of the nasopharynx or paranasal sinuses, here also without any marrow plasmacytosis. Here what will happen, M component will be there but without any marrow plasmacytosis. So both tumors are highly responsive to local radiation therapy. So these tumors are highly responsive to local radiation therapy. So if an M component is present, it should disappear after treatment. The solitary bone plasmacytoma, so they recur in other bony sites or evolve into myeloma. Only single site, no, but they may recur in other bony sites or they can evolve into myeloma. Extramedullary plasmacytomas, they rarely recur or progress. So extramedullary plasmacytomas, they rarely recur or they progress. So then defining what is a symptomatic multiple myeloma. So here what should be there, bone marrow plasma cells or biopsy proven bony or extramedullary plasmacytoma, and any or one or more of the following myeloma defining events. So what are these myeloma defining events? Hypercalcemia, that is 1 mg per deciliter higher than the upper limit of normal. So if we take this calcium, so this should be greater than 1 mg per deciliter higher than upper limit of normal. Renal insufficiency, that is serum creatinine greater than 2 mg per deciliter or creatinine clearance less than 40 ml per minute. So renal insufficiency, creatinine greater than 2 or creatinine clearance less than 40 ml per minute. Anemia, hemoglobin value of greater than 20 gram greater than 2 gram per deciliter below the lower limit of normal, or a hemoglobin value less than 10 gram per deciliter, okay, or less than 100 gram per liter. Bony lesions, one or more osteolytic lesions on skeletal radiography. So if we do a skeletal radiography, there should be osteolytic lesions, and any or more of the following biomarkers of malignancy. So what should be there? CRAB criteria, hypercalcemia, renal failure, anemia and bony lytic lesions, and clonal bone marrow plasma cell percentage. So what should be the bone marrow plasma cell percentage? Greater than or equal to 60%. Involved by uninvolved serum free light chain ratio greater than or equal to 100%, and greater than one focal lesion on MRI studies. So clonal bone marrow plasma cell percentage greater than or equal to 60%. Plasma cells greater than or equal to 60%, involved or uninvolved serum free light chain ratio greater than or equal to 100%, and greater than one focal lesion on MRI studies. So what is a solitary plasmacytoma? So it is a biopsy proven solitary lesion of either the bone or soft tissue. So in that biopsy, there should be evidence of clonal plasma cells. See, there is a normal bone marrow with no evidence of clonal plasma cells, and normal skeletal survey and MRA of spine and pelvis except for that primary solitary lesion, and there should be absence of end organ damage like hypercalcemia. So here only what will be there, only that biopsy proven single bone lesion will be there. Bone marrow, end organ damage, nothing will be there. So this is about After this, serum protein electrophoresis and measurement of serum immunoglobulins and free light chains are useful for detecting and characterizing M spikes, supplemented by immunoelectrophoresis, which is especially sensitive for identifying low concentration of M components not detectable by protein electrophoresis. Supposing if a serum protein electrophoresis will be there, what will happen? There will be the M component. So the M component will be increased in the gamma globulin region, albumin region, alpha 1, alpha 2 and beta, and here in the gamma globulin region, so M component, so this is called as a church spire pattern. So here in this gamma globulin region on protein electrophoresis, we can see this M component. And after knowing M component and with the immunoelectrophoresis, we have to determine what is there in the M component, whether it is IgG, IgM, whether it is kappa or lambda. So that is done through immunoelectrophoresis. So serum protein electrophoresis and measurement of serum immunoglobulins and free light chains are useful for detecting and characterizing. So here it is a M spike. And later, this is supplemented by immunoelectrophoresis. So this is especially sensitive for, so here no, here in M spike in protein electrophoresis, we can't detect which immunoglobulin. But if you do this immunoelectrophoresis, we can quantify whether it is IgG, IgM or kappa or lambda. 24-hour urine specimen is necessary to quantitate benzoin's protein, immunoglobulin, light chain excretion. So if there are light chains, so these are excreted in urine. So this urine specimen is necessary to quantitate this benzoin's protein, immunoglobulin, light chain excretion. So the serum M component. So what will be the component, serum M component? So it will be IgG in 53% of patients. So most of the patients, it will be IgG, IgA in 25% and IgD in 1%. Serum M component will be IgG in 53%, IgA in 25% and IgD in 1%. So 20% of patients will have only light chains in the serum and urine. So 20% of the patients, no, they will have only light chains in the serum as well as in the urine. So dipsticks for detecting proteinuria are not reliable at identifying light chains, and the heat test for detecting benzoin's proteins is falsely negative in 50% of the patients with light chain myeloma. So if dipsticks, if we do for detecting proteinuria, so they can't identify the light chains, and the heat test for detecting this benzoin's proteins, it is falsely negative in 50%. Though there are light chains, but it is false negative in 50% of patients with light chain myeloma, and fewer than 1% of patients have no identifiable M component. These patients usually have light chain myeloma in which renal catabolism has made the light chains undetectable in the urine. So in most of these patients, light chains can now be detected. So because of all the complications for detecting these light chains in the urine, so because of this, now we have light chains which can be detected by a serum free light chain assay. So we can detect these light chains in the serum itself. So this is serum free light chain assay. IgD myeloma may also present with light chain disease. IgD myeloma, so this also IgD, it is seen only in 1%, most it is IgG. About 2/3 of patients with serum M components, they also have urinary light chains. 2/3 of the patients with the serum M components, so they can also have urinary light chain. So the light chain isotype, so this have an impact on disease behavior, whether it is kappa or lambda. So the light chain isotype, so this has got an impact on the disease behavior. So whether this is due to some genetically important determination of cell proliferation or because lambda light chains are more likely to cause renal damage and form amyloid than or kappa light chains is unclear. Lambda light chains, no? Or they are more likely to cause renal damage and form amyloid than or kappa light chains. So this is unclear. The heavy chain isotype may have an impact. So the heavy chain isotype is also important. About half of patients with IgM paraproteins, if it is IgM, no, they develop hyperviscosity compared with only 2-4% of patients with IgA and IgG M component. So if M component is IgG or IgA, there won't be any hyperviscosity. But if it is IgM, they develop hyperviscosity. Among IgG myelomas, it is the IgG3 subclass, so that has the highest tendency to form both concentration and temperature dependent segregates. So among the IgG myeloma, so it is the IgG3 subclass, so this has got the highest tendency to form both concentration and temperature dependent aggregates. So this leading to hyperviscosity and cold agglutination at lower serum concentration. So among IgG myeloma, so this is the IgG3 subclass. So this has got the highest tendency to form both concentration and temperature dependent aggregates. So this leading to hyperviscosity and cold agglutination at lower serum concentrations. A standard workup directed at detecting monoclonal plasma cells. So what is the standard workup that has to be done? So this is the standard investigation therapy. So bone marrow aspirate and biopsy, or fine needle aspiration of plasma cytoma. So clonality by kappa or lambda immunostaining by flow cytometry, or clonality can also be detected by immunohistochemistry. So clonality, serum light chain assay. And then we have investigations to evaluate clonal paraprotein, serum protein electrophoresis and immunofixation. Then we can also have the quantitative serum immunoglobulin levels. We can measure the immunoglobulin levels. And then we have this 24-hour urine protein electrophoresis and immunofixation, serum free light chain and ratio. And then we have immunofixation for IgD or IgE in select cases. In select cases, normally it is IgG, but in select cases, immunofixation can be done for IgD or IgE in select cases. So, and then we have to investigate for clonal paraprotein. Here for clonal plasma cells, here we are detecting clonal plasma cells. Here we are detecting clonal paraprotein. Clonality by kappa or lambda immunostaining by flow cytometry or immunohistochemistry. So anemia, renal function, calcium, skeletal survey for bone lesions, and PET CT or MRI if smoldering multiple myeloma or solitary plasma cytoma with no other evidence of end organ damage or extramedullary disease. Investigation for risk stratification. So this is the what is the prognostic score. And then we also have to detect FISH for hyper diploidy, deletion 17p, translocations 414, 1114, 1416, 14, 14, 14, 414, 1114 and 1416, 1420 and then LDH and deletion 13. And specialized investigations like abdominal fat pad for amyloid. So what are the specialized investigation? Abdominal fat pad for amyloid, serum viscosity if IgM component or high IgA levels or serum M component greater than 7 gram per deciliter. So if IgM M component is there, we have to determine the serum viscosity or high IgA levels or if serum high IgA levels greater than 7 grams per deciliter, and if it is IgM component, then we have immunoglobulin M. So then we have to determine the MYD88 and CXCR4 mutation analysis. So if it is IgM component, we have to detect MYD88 and CXCR4 mutational analysis. So here you can see the lytic lesion in multiple lytic lesions in multiple myeloma. So chest and bone radiograph may reveal lytic lesions, or there can be diffuse osteopenia, lytic lesions as well as osteopenia. So MRI, so this offers a sensitive means to document extent of bone marrow infiltration and cord or root compression in pains in patients with pain syndrome. And 18 FDG PET or CT, it is a valuable tool to assess bone damage and detect extramedullary sites of the disease. If there are any extramedullary sites of the disease, so this 18 FDG PET or CT, so this is a valuable tool to assess the bone damage and detect the extramedullary sites of the disease. So the use of this 18F FDG PET CT is recommended to distinguish between smoldering and active multiple myeloma. Use of this 18-fluorodeoxyglucose PET or CT. So this is recommended to distinguish between smoldering and active multiple myeloma, and to confirm a suspected diagnosis of solitary plasmacytoma. And it is also a valuable tool to evaluate response in patients with oligo or non-secretory myeloma. So this 18 FDG PET or CT, no? So this is also a valuable tool to evaluate the response in patients with oligo or non-secretory myeloma. So what is this?